need so that you'll be properly equipped to go forward to the Dawah effectively, inshallah. That's the main aim of Dawah Wise. And with this aim, we had started to talk about evolution in the last few weeks and sessions. And in this week, inshallah, we continue our journey across the landscape of Darwinism and the theory of evolution. And our special guest, Brother Sabur, has discussed the evolution from an epistemological point of view last week. So what we'll do is rather ask Brother Sabur, if you don't mind, just summarize again the conclusions from the last episode that we had so that we can deeply dive into it into Q&A this week, inshallah. So go ahead.
Jazakallah khair. So to summarize, the first thing that we obviously mentioned is that Muslims love science. We don't have a problem with science. We let scientists flourish. Even scientists that come up with so-called heretical ideas in Islamic history, they were not burnt at the stake. Islam allows a free inquiry, freedom of speech in the academic domain, even the philosophical domain, whether things are in line with orthodoxy or they're not, they are to be refuted and challenged by the force of sophisticated arguments rather than thrusting spears into the hearts of our opponents.
Ah, you don't burn people in the stake, eh? Especially for free speech. Okay, Sabur. This is what happened in the birthplace of Sabur, Pakistan, just yesterday, guys.
Seems like every time Pakistan is in the news, it has something to do with a mob of morons shouting Allahu Akbar while brutally murdering someone for hurting their feelings over the most obvious false prophet in history. Today is no different. Let's read about a factory manager who was beaten, murdered, and set on fire for blasphemy while the crowd cheered with glee and posed for selfies in front of the burning body. We won't bother going to Islam's most trusted sources unless someone says something really stupid about this having nothing to do with Islam.
It's no coincidence science suffocates in the Muslim world. Here are some reasons how Islam kills science. A. It makes societies value superstition over reason. B. It kills freedom of speech and freedom of conscience. C. It keeps half of the human capital, women in other words, uneducated and not being able to pursue an academic career with a toxic patriarchy. D. Islam provides the delusion on people that they know stuff before scientific investigation. E. Islam demonizes foreign influences and knowledge as it did with the Mutazilites and the translation movement, ending the Islamic golden era. Okay, accusing scientists of being heretics and all this kind of stuff. D. It promotes Islamic faith schools and waste the time of people with useless rituals. Okay. Five times a day rituals. It wastes the time of people. Islamic educational system focus on mythology and waste the time of students reading useless books like the Quran. Imagine how many times Muslim students waste reading useless books, mythology, urban myths. Imagine, instead of reading a science book. E. The exemplars of Muslim youth are not scientists, they are dying. Instead caring to make a better world, they care to promote Islam.
So Muslims are not shy of critical thinking. We're not shy of any philosophical or scientific challenges. So Muslims are not shy of critical thinking. We're not shy of any philosophical or scientific challenges.
Oh, really, eh? Really? So now if I put in a... Guys, I have put so many times this clip with Sabur, but let's put it again. So... You are for critical thinking, Sabur, eh? You are not shy. Okay, let's see.
There is a Muslim who is looking at the world through lenses, green lenses, and he's looking at the world as green. And there is a non-Muslim who is looking at the world through red lenses. So what's happening in the conversation is the Muslim is saying, this is green, this is green, this is green. The non-Muslim is saying, this is red, this is red, this is red. Why is that? The reason is, this is the case, is because the Muslim is looking at the world through the lenses of La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. He believes that this man, called Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the final messenger of God. Therefore, whatever he says is true.
Now, what I want to do is this. These are aspects of Islam that we all believe in and accept. What if I come along and I tell you something? I tell you hypothetically, before you do takfir on me, hypothetically, there is a sahih narration of the Prophet ﷺ that you have to wear a yellow hat on Sundays. Hypothetically. Raise your hand if you're going to wear a yellow hat on Sundays.
Sabur, I'm really touched with your skepticism. How is it possible, my friend? I mean, I don't think any other person in human history is less of a skeptic. That kind of tragedy, not even in Greek tragedies, my friend. Oedipus married his mother and killed his father. My friend, if you are a skeptic, I am a black female stripper in Las Vegas. I am more of a black female stripper in Las Vegas than you are a skeptic, my friend. Literally, my friend. Okay, literally. Not even if you try, you cannot be that of a tragedy. Anyway, let's continue.
As Muslims, we have no issue with science. We love science. We consider science to be a form of ibadah. We consider it to be a way of getting close to the Creator. As Hassan ibn Haytham, 1,000 years ago, remarked,
Hassan ibn Haytham was a heretic, my friend, was a secularist. And you know that. This is the annoying stuff. This guy knows that.
So they weren't even doing anything. They weren't the facilitators of the Golden Age, nor were they weren't even the initial the Golden Age did not occur because of the Mu'tazila. That's basically it. Yeah. So that would be the first two things I would say. And did you want me to go through all the factors as to why that's problematic? Or
I wanted you to just briefly go over each one of them, but just as you just finished off this part here, one of the contentions which Hoodboy makes, oops, said his name, and others have made, is that even if we look at the main figures, right, if they were Mu'tazilites, they were definitely heretics. So if anybody did anything good or there was a major figure within the Islamic Golden Age, they were most likely some sort of heretic.
Ah, now they are heretics. So it wasn't because of Islam, in other words. But I thought Islam is for science. Now they are the heretics. Sabur. In a short autobiography, Ibn al-Haytham tells us that in his youth, he scrutinized the claims of many religious sects teeming around him. In the end, it was the empirical strain and rational thinking he recognized in Aristotelian natural philosophy and the rigor of mathematics that finally won his heart. An early essay of his, now lost, was entitled All Matters Secular and Religious Are the Fruits of the Philosophical Sciences. In his time, philosophy comprised all of mathematics, the natural sciences, and theology, or metaphysics. He wrote on arithmetics, astronomy, music, ethics, politics, and poetry. Defended astrology as a science based on a mathematical proof and criticized contemporary Muslim theological theses, as well as positions taken by followers of the Christian philosopher and theologian Philoponus, who were active in Baghdad. Sobur, what you give in history as evidence that Islam supports science are in fact evidence for the opposite. The Muslim scientists in the Islamic Golden Era were secularists following ancient Greek mindset. Okay. Your traditional Islam, the Islam you and your friend Daniel Hakikatsu represent, ended this era. Can you understand, Sobur, can you understand now the magnitudes of your error? Why these scientists are not more popular? Because the West is racist? No, because you don't give a rat's ass about these scientists who you consider heretics. Okay? So you are giving an example, my friend, that demonstrates the complete opposite of what you are claiming to demonstrate.
Another brilliant mind was Al-Haytham, who wrote extensively about astronomy, mathematics, optics, and visual perception. He established the modern scientific method and thereby became the first legitimate scientist in history. The Golden Age also saw advances in medicine thanks to Ibn Sina, whose work remained in use for the following six centuries. Yet many of the great minds of the Islamic Golden Age were also fierce critics of the literal interpretation of the Quran. For instance, Al-Biruni, who calculated that the earth revolved around the sun and rotated on its axis, challenged the literal creed of Ibn Hanbal by insisting that it was essential to question everything from religion to philosophy. The rational position was shared by Al-Razi, who was a scholar of Da Vinci's magnitude and once argued that Islam without reason had no value. Then there was Khayyam, one of the most influential thinkers of the Middle Ages. He was a fierce patron of humanism and expressed secular ideas in opposition to the design of Sharia law. Another leading scholar was Ibn Rushd, who advocated for the emancipation of women and stressed that matters of belief should be decided only on the basis of reason and evidence.
As Muslims, we have no issue with science. We love science. We consider science to be a form of ibadah. We consider it to be a way of getting close to the Creator. As Hassan ibn Haytham, 1,000 years ago, remarked, that it is the study of nature which brings us closer to our Creator. And him being a prominent figure in the history of science, in the development of the scientific method, that gives us a paradigm from which Muslims see the role of science and faith. So when it comes to any scientific theory, if it contradicts supposedly our understanding of the Quranic verses or the narrations of the Prophet, peace be upon him, such as the earth going around, the sun having an orbit rather than being stationary, or whether it's to do with the soul or biological evolution, the creation of Adam alayhi salam, parting of the seas, the virgin birth of Isa alayhi salam, all of these things which supposedly contradict science, what we would do is we would say, well, we do not reject the science, whatever it is, as a valid scientific theory or theories and paradigms and theories and models. However, we would not reject the clear-cut Quranic paradigm when it comes to the virgin birth or the creation of Adam al-Islam or any other miracle. We would simply say that we have independent reasons for why we believe the Quran to be true. Hence, we can actually hold on to these two beliefs. We can hold on to the belief in valid scientific theories, yet believe in these miracles. In fact, we can flourish within a scientific field.
Yet you don't flourish. That's the thing, though. Sobur, the Islamic world is a black hole of science because of your ideas. First of all, that is what you claim right now. That's not representing of Islamic history or Islamic community or Islamic culture. That is what you, a single person. Okay, that supposedly that we can believe in science and also believe in the Quran, although they are contradictory. We both believe in both things. That is what you invented, I don't know, a year ago. Okay. That's the first. Secondly, you personally, how many thousand Muslims, I will dare say half of the Muslim world, whoever deals with evolution, for example, because of you personally, is misguided about evolution. You personally, Sobhoor Ahmed, made thousands of people misunderstand evolution, a scientific theory. Okay, so you spread misinformation. Okay, so you say, and your friend Hamza Georges, you say that if science contradicts Islam, we trust Islam and not science, because science is changing. Isn't that what you say? Isn't that what you teach in classrooms? Now because he read a book about epistemology, so Sobhoor Ahmed now lately says that, okay, we accept scientific theories as working models, but then we don't take them as true, as absolute truth. Okay, that is what you say, a couple of months. Yet you made hundreds of thousands of people doubt a scientific fact, Sobhoor. And you make a whole whole crusade to undermine science. You and Hamza Georges make a crusade to undermine science for years. So we are touched again with your you can trust two contradictory things, because it's a working theory and the other is, and whatever.
Sometimes we belittle the Quran accidentally. When we see an ayah in the Quran that talks about, for example, the camels and how we created it, or when Allah says that you are an alaqa, you are a nutfatin min maniyin.
Did you catch that? Investigating the Quran is belittling the Quran. So, according to Hamza Georges, the Quran is over the investigative ability of science. So he gives insane, undeserving status to the Quran. At the same time, he proves he's completely incompetent to make an honest analysis when it comes to these issues.
This is wrong, because what we've done, we've made science into a god now. We've deified science and we've limited the Quran. Science changes. I've just spent a whole year studying the philosophy of science on a postgrad level, and I'm telling you, there's no certainty in science. Always defeasible. I'll bring out my notes, my postgrad notes for you to see now. Because you have some online idiots, no offense, don't want to swear, but you have online idiots from, you know, the skeptic tradition and the aggressive atheists. They think, oh, you know, science is like wahi, it's like revelation. It's not. It changes.
Hamza Georges just said that science is less reliable than revelations because science is changing. Or in other words, science is less reliable than the Quran because science is changing. Okay. Guys, let me explain how that works. Sobhoor Ahmed and Hamza Georges are blind cultists. They have invested psychologically to Islam. So they need to defend by all means the proposition Islam is true. So for their concern, Islam is true. Okay, like we say, I love my child. So they need to defend this proposition by all means. So we have a fact, Islam is true. But then they see science contradicting that. So what we do, they abuse the philosophy of science or epistemology, what we can really know, okay, to keep deluding themselves, Islam is true. It's all about these people feeling happy in the psychotic delusion. So in other words, they prefer mentally masturbating than reality. They made a choice. They say, I prefer my masturbation to masturbate mentally than reality. But that's not enough, because Islam needs also to be supreme. So they want to spread their mindset. They want all the world to be wankers. So they want all the world to be wankers, because Islam needs to be supreme. So these people, in other words, put over human well-being their masturbation. Okay, so they feel a warm feeling when they masturbate, mentally masturbate, but then let's enslave the world under an evil cult, because we enjoy masturbating. What can we do? So they tune their skepticism to always conclude Islam is true. What is tuning skepticism? Overstating reason and evidence when it fits my argument, understating reason and evidence when it doesn't fit my argument, or destroy completely the foundations of reason and evidence when my argument is hopeless.
So in the beginning of my video, I said this is the way I am defining a fact for the purposes of this discussion.
And what
I
is
said,
that definition?
Yeah. And that's the definition I used. Yeah.
What is one?
Which I said was something absolute, something that's not going to change, and something that can't be revised.
So, according to Ahmed Sobur, when he investigates evolution, a fact is something absolute, something that is not going to change, and something that cannot be revised. In other words, Sobur said that the science of evolution is not a fact, as the requirements he sets for something to be a fact cannot be met by definition.
There are miraculous parts of this book which cannot be explained using human agency. And that's something we can objectively argue about. The second point is, if you sincerely, as a human being, you ask for guidance, God will show you this is the truth. But that's not an objective argument. So the first one is. So let me explain to you why.
But wait, Sobur, I thought facts are something absolute, something that's not going to change, and something that cannot be revised. Ah, that's not facts. No, facts is something that we can objectively verify. That is facts. No. Okay, sorry. I misunderstood. Okay, please go on.
Now, what's the criteria to test whether something is or is not a genuine prophecy? I want to ask you that. How would you discern the truth from falsehood?
You'd use empirical evidence.
Exactly. You would use empirical evidence. Something verifiable, something falsifiable, and something precise.
Ah, three again. Something verifiable, something falsifiable, and something precise. It's not the other three. Something absolute, something that is not going to change, and something that cannot be revised. Now with the prophecies, is something verifiable. We'll happily say that even a hug might be enough when it comes to accept Islam.
Innate disposition, has a ruh, a soul, has a qalb, a heart, has an aql, and the intellect is a function of the heart in Islamic tradition, and it has a fitrah, and the fitrah is clouded. And within the fitrah, the innate disposition, there are forms of proto-knowledge in the Islamic tradition that God is a reality and that he's worthy of worship, but that clouded. So it could be that a sound, rational argument, philosophical argument, whatever, can uncloud your innate disposition to awaken the truth within, or it could be something else, or it could be a combination of things. So when you ask me, it needs to be demonstrated, well, I need to find out who you are, because I don't know where your cloud is. Maybe you need a rational argument. Maybe you need a good hug. Maybe you need some love. Maybe you need some really strong Quranic verses to wake you up, because the reason for your disbelief is arrogance, right?
So when it comes to reject evolution, Hamza Georges becomes the greatest philosopher that ever lived. Okay, he bends the limits of philosophy. We can't really know anything. What is truth? How we know truth is truth? How we know? We can't know anything. Logical absolutes. Okay, so when it comes to accept evolution, Hamza Georgis becomes skeptic in limits of insanity. How we know A is A? We can't really know anything. Okay. But when it comes to accepting Islam, a hug is enough. A hug. What else do you need? Just a hug. Is that tuning skepticism? Is that tuning skepticism? Or maybe I'm wrong. When it comes to accept evolution, guys, Hamza Georgis rejects language. Okay, how I know what you say is actually what you say? Maybe your words are not... When it comes to accept Islam, a hug is enough. A hug. A hug. Okay, you are one guess. You tune your skepticism to always conclude Islam is true, my friend.
Certain instances in history, I pointed out in terms of how science fluctuates, Newtonian model, the Einsteinian model, and how, you know, you have these Kuhnian paradigm shifts. This goes to show us that, you know, philosophy of science teaches that science actually is not absolute. The beauty of science is that it changes over time. I summarized the problem of induction, the problem of underdetermination, the problem of unconceived alternatives, theory ladenness, and methodological naturalism. So all of these combined shows us that science doesn't give you absolute truths, and our issue is with scientism, and with scientism broadly defined as the idea that the only beliefs that we hold which are rational to hold are those which can be scientifically empirically verified, and that obviously goes against everything we know in basic epistemology, morals, mathematics, metaphysics, testimony, self-evident truths. All of these things, which compromise a large part of the beliefs that we hold to be rational, are absolutely not scientific from the perspective that they can be empirically verified. In fact, even the statement that science is the only route to truth cannot be scientifically verified. So our beef, our problem, our issue is with scientism, not with science.
Scientism is the overstatement of the truth-bearing ability of science. When in fact, Sobur, you understate the truth-bearing ability of science. Your beef is with everything that goes against Islam. You are a blind cultist. You know nothing about epistemology. You are dreadful on epistemology. Epistemology was meant to help people investigate truth. Sobur uses epistemology to misdirect, blur the waters, and confuse people against truth. In the case of Sobur, his study on epistemology made him even more blind than he was before. Now he's a confident blind cultist. Philosophy, when it aims truth, opens our eyes. Philosophy, when it aims propaganda and apologetics, makes us blinked. Sobur and his friend Hamza Georgis invented the science of gullibility, or how I like to call that, mental masturbation. Hamza Georgis and Sobur Ahmed train Muslims how to be confident idiots. They don't engage in epistemology, they abuse philosophy for blind faith. And now, after destroying Sobur for the 10th time, let's go to the real purpose of my videos, which is for me to sing karaoke in a huge crowd. Okay. Ella. Sorry about that. One moment, please. Ella. What? Why I cannot hear anything? What's that? Wait.
Sunnah.
Way on the other side.